It's all a wish. They're all wishes. Everything's a wish in the book, right? I mean, yeah. I mean, everything in the book is like a wish. So it's like, that's the unification of it, is that... is that, like, you know, I wish that I wish that, you know... Like, in the book it says that when I was young, I got... It's just true, I got hit on the head with an axe and almost died. And that I was in so much pain that I wanted to die, and I wished that I was dead. And then that really... And then it interested me that I wanted to be dead. And then I started making these wishes, which is true. I started making these... It's just wishing for the most impossible thing to try to understand everything. So, and I still do that. So yeah, it's all just, you know, it's just like me wishing for a way to, I don't know, save George or know that I was important to him. I guess that's really what it's about, is like this kind of wish to know that I was important to him and not being able to never ever know. And so, I don't know, to me that was the unifying thing, is that it's all a wish. I mean, you know, and then the sex and death stuff is just, I don't know, because it's a little bit about the cycle, it's a little bit about the books, the five books, I wanted to go back there and kind of be, you know, kind of connected to them, so in like kind of rise out of it or explain a little bit about why I write about those things and how they relate to George or something, what, you know. So there's a little bit of it kind of, I don't think you have to read the cycle to let know the book, I don't think it's important at all, but I think there's a little bit of like trying to kind of like explain a little bit why I wrote those books for him or something. Yeah, you know, I think confusion is the truth. That's my saying. So, no, I mean, you can follow it through and you can see, it always returns to George, so like, I try to go away from George, and then it always comes back to George killing himself. It's just like, it's like this, I can't get away from it. So you can see the book keeps coming back and back to the same moment when he kills himself. So in that sense, it kind of makes sense, but I just wanted it to be about feeling. I wanted people just to sort of be confused, but also feel things. I didn't want to have a kind of story that distracted you. I wanted people to just relax and kind of like just trust it or something, trust it and sort of move through it. And then by the end, I think that the idea is that it would then become a whole, you know, and that it would be like unified by my sincerity and my, you know, my need to write about George. That's like, that was all that really mattered. And so, yeah, no, I mean, I like, you know, I like, making it difficult for the reader. So, and myself, it's not a memoir, you know, it's a novel. The wishes in the book that I said that I didn't really make those wishes. It doesn't matter because it's like, you know, I don't know. I mean, I am ultimately, you know, this kind of complicated writer who needs to structure everything. So not, you know, that's really important. And so not everything in there is completely true. You know, it's emotionally really true. The only thing that in the book that's really completely true is there's one section that about the night I met him when he was on LSD. There's one little section there, and that's completely true. That's the only thing in the book that, like I said, I have to write something that's completely true. But the rest of it is, I mean, I guess the parts where I'm really upset are true. So, no, that's a bit of a fictional device, yeah. I don't like writing about myself. It's very difficult for me to write about myself. I don't do it very much, or hardly ever. And it's just like, at least the conceit in the book is that I need to, like, see myself as a character to be able to write about me. I can't just explode. I mean, I do at certain points, but it's easier for me to like look at myself as a third person, as another person, and then write about myself that way because it's too personal or something. So it's a kind of distancing device that I, at certain points, I think I need to use to explain things. Yeah, I mean, it's really that. I'm interested in James Turrell in general. I'm interested in his work, and I'm interested in what he tries to do. And it seemed to suit, I don't know, the impossibility of what he's trying to do with what I'm doing. Also, I mean, I also have this refrain about the crater, you know. So I wanted it, that's connecting up to the fact that he shot himself in the head and left a crater in his head, which comes up in later in the book, and also that I got hit on top of the axe. So part of that is a kind of setting up a refrain with certain, you know, with a kind of an image that repeats. I mean, that's one of the reasons, that's how I structure my work is to have like these refrains of images and things that make it unify. So that kind of made the crater, that made it being set in a crater become the most, probably the main reason I chose it. I don't know. I'm interested in that crater. I'm interested in that project. And he looks like Santa Claus, you know. So, I mean, there are a lot of little reasons why I thought, oh, he looks like Santa Claus. So he could be sort of like, you know, if you go, because Santa Claus gives that fairy tale to Dennis to try to help George with, and then he goes in there, and then James Turrell looks like Santa Claus because he does. He has a long beard, and that made it work too a little bit. It was like it kind of just unified the Santa Claus, and I don't know. So a lot of it's just like these little details that make everything kind of unify in the writing to sort of become the whole thing. I mean, that section is just like I wanted, because George had been a fictional character in the George Moss Cycle books, a Closer First Tribe, guide and period. I wanted him I wanted there to be this kind of like magical transition. So for him to start as a totally fictional character, and then in through that section, he transforms into the real person. So, and I'm not sure why I don't remember why I chose the father and son and why it's in Russia. It's sort of a strange thing, but just to make it, I guess, just to put it really far away or something. I wanted George to like start there and then escape through different characters until he became himself, sort of like transition into himself. But I don't know about the fathers. I didn't even realize I was doing that. So I'm usually like really, really aware of every single thing I do. But that's something I didn't even think about. Maybe, I mean, George was younger than me, and I took care of him, and so that might be, it might just be that, is that I had to take care of George and watch over him and try to help him and stuff. And so it put me in kind of a parental position with him, because he was, because it's like he was a child when I met him, and then he became an adult, but he never really became an adult because he broke apart. I mean, that was the thing with George, is that when he was a little kid, it's like I always thought that's who George is, because he became so confusing that you didn't know who he was anymore, and he didn't know who he was anymore. So I would always think, like, that little kid I met when he was 12 is like, that's who's in there. That's who's in that. That's who's in this deep, deep mental illness, is this little boy. And now that's who he is now, as he's become the adult version of that boy, even though. And he actually liked that idea too. He would get excited by the idea that he had been someone, because he thought he was no one. He thought he was just, I mean, he was on so much medication, and he was so deeply bipolar that he really wasn't a real person. He was like extremes, like manic and very depressive, and then these medications would make him a whole person, but he wasn't like a real person. He was like this artificial person, and he felt that very much, which is one of the reasons why it was so hard for him. So anyway, in that sense, maybe that's a really parental thing, is like that I always thought of him as being this child who, and then I imagined what this child would have become if he had become an adult, you know. And that's who I, so when I was with George, I would think, okay, the real George, even though he's being so strange and being so impossible, it's like the real George is in there, and that's who I'm going to be talking to, and that's who I'm going to be concentrating on. Yeah, that's kind of parental, I guess. But yeah, no, I always felt, for years and years and years, I wanted to rewrite that book, do something where I rewrote Picard's Lonely Hunter, because I felt really connected to it, and I wanted to write a novel that was that, which I guess is now I wish, but But yeah, I did. I did. I don't know why, but I felt really connected to that character who gave everything to everyone and no one ever thought he needed anything. And I mean, I felt really, especially with Militia to George, it was just like I was always having to give, and I never got anything. And it was, and I obviously liked doing that, but at the same time, it was, you know, I felt so alone and I felt so, you know, confused by that. So that really hit me. Yeah. The thing is that I'm not a lonely person. I never feel lonely. I mean, I'm very concentrated on my work and my imagination, and I'm just not a lonely person. But when I was younger, and I guess specific to George, it was difficult to be with someone who was so messed up, because you'd be with someone, but you would also not be, you wouldn't know what, you didn't, I didn't know what, you know, as for instance, I mean, I used to go, when he turned about 13, he started getting very, he was 13, 14, he started getting really, really sick, really depressed, and he hadn't been so before. And his mother, who, his parents hated me, and they thought I was a bad influence on him, and they, for a while, they prevented us from seeing one another because they didn't like me, and they thought I had terrible designs on George, which I didn't. Actually, George had terrible designs on me, but that's another, but they suddenly realized we need someone to help, so they would call me up, his mother would call me up and say, can you come sit with George? He's really depressed, can you please come over? And so I'd go over there all the time and just, he'd be in bed just lying there like this, like, ugh. And I would just sit there with him for hours, and he would barely talk, right? And then finally I'd have to go, and then later he would say, oh, that helped so much. And I'd be like, but you were just lying there, I didn't do anything. So it was like, it was lonely in that sense. It's like I'd be with him, and I liked him so much, and I wanted to talk to him, and yeah, he would just be there. He would just be like completely depressed, you know? And so that was a kind of loneliness because, I don't know, you know what I mean? It's like you're with someone and you really care about them and you want to connect with them, and they just literally can't talk to you. They can't do it. And it's hard not to take it personally, even though it wasn't really personal. So maybe that was certainly a deep, deep, deep feeling of isolation, and also like, why am I doing this? Why am I like helping this person? Why do I want, you know, he's completely messed up. It's like, I should just stop, you know, I should stop trying to be so close to him because he can't be close to me. But at the same time, it was like, if I don't do it, he's going to feel really terrible because he relies on me. So is that loneliness? I don't know. But it was a terrible feeling. Maybe that was loneliness. But generally, as an adult, I just don't feel lonely. I never feel lonely. You know? I don't know. It's weird. No, I wrote them all different kinds of order. I'm trying to remember. I mean, one of them, there's a section that was like, I actually used a different version of it in a theater piece for Giselle. There's a section called Torn from Something. And it was originally, I wrote it, and then I decided to use it for this piece. So it was for this piece called The Pyre. And so that was the oldest thing. And then, I don't know, I just started thinking, oh, I wanted to write about this, The Heart is a Lonely Hunter by Carson McCullers, because that was like a big thing. And then I thought, oh, I should be, and then that kind of made me think like, oh, what would Santa Claus do if Santa Claus knew George? So then I just started, yeah, and then it was just like, oh, well, and so it kind of felt like that. Those were, and then like, wow, Santa Claus was giving me letting me have a fairy tale to live in. And so it was just like, no, they were all over the place. But then I started to see how they worked together. And because I started writing it, and then I stopped for about 4 years because I got confused. And then because I was making films with Zach Farley and also making novels out of animated GIFs and things. And then I went back to it, and then I was like, oh, then it made sense to me. It was like, oh, I can see the structure. I didn't see it before because I was just writing. And I was like, oh, so then I started moving things around and making a composition and writing new parts to go with it. So it was more organic, really, this one, than my books usually are. That's true. That's true. Yeah, I don't know Jean-Paul. It's very strange. You know.